Welcome to the Virtual Memories Show. I'm your host, Gil Roth, and we're here to preserve and promote culture in this benighted age, one weekly conversation at a time. You can subscribe to the Virtual Memories Show through iTunes or by plugging our RSS feed into your favorite podcatcher. You can find the RSS feed on our websites, vmspod.com or chimeraobscura.com/vm. We're also on Twitter and Instagram at vmspod, at virtualmemoriespodcast.tumblr.com, and on Spotify, YouTube, and tunein.com by searching for Virtual Memories Show. And visit patreon.com/vmspod or paypal.me/vmspod to make a one-time or recurring donation and help me continue to produce smart conversation about books, art, comics, and culture every week at the Virtual Memories Show. Well, it is kind of, sort of, the end of the year. At least, this is the last conversation episode we're going to be posting in 2019. I'm hoping to get the guest list episode up a little bit before New Year's. We'll see where that goes. Depends on how many people respond. Honestly, I was hemming and hawing about trying to double up episodes a few weeks in December so I could get in all the great conversations I've recorded in the last couple of weeks. And then I realized it's actually a good thing to have like 5 episodes in the can heading into winter. I've got a few new episodes lined up for January, but this also means I am buffered in case of bad weather or other weird cancellations. Something happened last week where I had to cancel one of the 3 that I was recording. So, you know, stuff happens. Not that you guys care too much about what actually goes into my scheduling the show. But I'll be honest, I legitimately had a moment recently where I was trying to do this whole jigsaw puzzle of episodes, figuring out who could go when based on time and this, that, and the other. And then it hit me how much serious work-related stuff I still need to take care of before the end of the year. And I had to tell myself, Gil, without the job, there's no podcast. So get back to that. Unless, of course, one of you wants to pay me a 6-figure salary to do this, in which case, you know, I'm game. Anyway, like I say, it's the end of the year. It's been a doozy. I have recorded some great episodes over the course of 2019. I made good friends, crossed a couple of names off of my Mount Rushmore dream list, Milton, Chris, and sadly, I lost some friends and guests also. I'm hoping for a good 2020, but the future, as Joe Strummer said, is unwritten. Now, this week's guest is the great political cartoonist and illustrator Peter Kuper. Peter was on at the beginning of this year, episode 303, early January, to talk about Kafkaesque, his collection of comic adaptations of Kafka's stories. This time around, he's here to talk about his adaptation of Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness, published last month by W.W. Norton. This is a wonderful adaptation of a challenging book, challenging for a bunch of reasons. First, the weirdness of Conrad's storytelling, which compelled Peter to make storytelling choices of his own, to eliminate or to illuminate the action of the novella while figuring out where to let the prose shine through, where to take things that just don't quite add up in terms of characters, or the narrator's reactions especially, and how to make the story flow without, of course, changing the intent of what Conrad was doing. On top of that, Peter had to cope with the, we'll say, racially problematic aspects of the Heart of Darkness and the time in which it was written, 1899. Given Peter's progressive credentials, Heart of Darkness is a potentially risky project, but he does a fantastic job of, well, A, telling the story, B, showing the world beyond that of the Europeans in Conrad's tale. The source book is canonical, and it has some key iconic moments in it that have been picked up throughout pop culture over the last century plus. And what Peter does graphically is manage to adapt it faithfully, but infusing it with the understanding or the greater understanding of our era. It's a really, really phenomenal job that he does. It makes for great comic storytelling. I mean, comic book storytelling, not ha-ha. I was floored by this one. I really wasn't sure what to expect or how much more I could get out of Heart of Darkness. And Peter shows there is still an awful lot there for us. So go check out Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness, adapted by Peter Kuper and published by W.W. Norton. Now, as caveats go, New York City noise always happens. Peter's studio, where we recorded, there's nowhere to use the tripod stands for the microphones, so we had them handheld. That means the levels might fluctuate a little based on gesticulation. Also, in our episode earlier this year, episode 303, Peter and I talk about his work process for comics like this. And it's a really illuminating segment in terms of how he draws, the sizes he draws, what the processes are, what comes out of that whole thing. I didn't want to go through it all here again. So if you're interested in sort of the nuts and bolts of how Peter makes these long form comics, go back and check out that episode. Now here's Peter's bio. Peter Kuper's work appears regularly in The New Yorker, The Nation, and Mad, where he has written and illustrated Spy versus Spy every issue since 1997. And we talk about the future of Mad in this one. He is the co-founder of World War III Illustrated, a political comics magazine now in its 40th year of publication. He has produced more than two dozen books, including Sticks and Stones, The System, Diario de Oaxaca, Ruins, which won the 2016 Eisner Award, and Kafkaesque, 14 stories. His new book is Heart of Darkness. Peter has lectured extensively throughout the world and has taught comics and illustration courses at Parsons, the School of Visual Arts, and Harvard University's first class dedicated to graphic novels. A frequent guest at literary festivals, Peter enjoys traveling the world, but will always call New York City his home. And now, the second 2019 Virtual Memories Conversation with Peter Kuper. So are you a cultural imperialist or appropriator in terms of, of doing Heart of Darkness? Did you feel a lot of tension in terms of representing Conrad, representing the story? And getting it non-racist, I guess?
Non-racist.
As non-racist as you could?
Yeah. Well, I was coming off of adapting Kafka for my book Kafkaesque. And so my adaptation muscles were pretty hardy at that, at that point. Diving into it, I definitely felt that pressure of... Well, first of all, it's such dark material. And I moved to Mexico for 4 months to start off the process because it was January when I was starting it. And I thought to work in New York City in cold weather to try and conjure up this book is going to be really difficult. And knowing that I had the project, I could plot and say to my wife, like, let's snowbird to Mexico and that it will be the right environment for me to roll up on this book. Well, pretty quickly, I got like one of those terrific flus that was like a month-long flu that was going around. And then we got some kind of insect infestation where we were like itching for like 2 months. And I was doing my research at that time, and I really felt like, oh no, what am I in for here? Because it's the Heart of Darkness, yeah, for sure. And I was looking at all this photography from that time period, and I'm seeing, you know, all the horrific images of what happened in the Congo, courtesy of King Leopold, and, you know, chopped off hands and starving people, and then reading all the backstory on it and getting, you know, doing a deep dive while I was feeling miserable was actually turned out to be kind of perfect because it got me in the full state of mind for working on with that material where I felt like I'm on this journey here. And some of what I could bring to it was my own horror at the subject and the material. And so my reactions to the story, I took it as like, I'm a 21st century now person who's going to be reading this yeah. story, and the things that were made me itchy that wasn't just the insects that infestation I had were things that I thought like I'm going to find a way to address this, because as a reader, being unsettled is one thing, and being confused even is another thing. Like that it's the text is, it's not straightforward in many ways. And as a reader, I think any reader will find it, the original text confusing at places, like why he jumped from that to this and what's going on. And I found that there was, both some of the confounding aspects I could clarify for myself, and therefore in adapting it, clarify for another reader. But also there was so much of the text that did not help the story along, and it didn't hurt it to remove it. It wasn't a whitewashing.
Yeah.
And even for that matter, just thinking of it in terms of, so what about the African perspective in this book that's missing? The characters are much more one-dimensional, and that it's not, I'm not required to keep them one-dimensional, and for that matter, not include their perspective. So just simply by turning the view, and so say one of the criticisms of the book by Chinua Achebe was that Conrad is describing Africa as a sort of like blank wall of trees, and I could show what was behind that wall of trees, and that didn't change the text at all. It just is simply the point of view that I could bring to it. And I wanted that point of view as a reader. So that, but yes, it was daunting because there was a lot of aspects of it that I were like, wow, okay. This is from 1899, and as enlightened as Conrad may have been in some ways, you know, that
you
wasn't,
only,
an
you can only be
period.
So far. Yeah. Were there ways in which the film adaptations of Heart of Darkness aided you in terms of trying to visualize certain scenes?
A little bit in just some photo references for going up the Congo River.
Okay. And I was wondering more of the between Apocalypse Now and some of the other adaptations, whether, oh, that's at least that's how they visualized, you know, what
right.
this meant. And,
well, you know, there was Nicholas Rogue did a horrifically sad adaptation that, you know, it had some good points in it. It had some good parts, and it was working very hard on trying to update the story, but I found it to be really pretty dreadful. And John Malkovich was playing Kurtz as an effeminate character, and it was just like there were so many odd notes in the movie, but there was some visual references for sure. Definitely, I mean, part of not so much the movies, but to tell the truth, the move, going to Mexico, being in an environment that was very warm, the sounds and the smells were an important part of it, as they are like when I travel, that, and I draw in my sketchbook, I realize what you can't replicate when you get back and have a photo, unless, you know, from memory, is that environment, like where you're standing in the sun and you're baking and you're uncomfortable and your back kind of hurts and there's flies in your face. Those details are enter into the drawing a bit, and, you know, some horrific smell or something burning plastic or menudo or whatever it is, or something that smells really good. And that all that, and the sounds that are end up, getting into the line work even. And so I had that being in Mexico. And when I got back, I was able to carry a lot of that with me while I was doing the ultimate drawing, but I also would like open Google and go to Sounds of the Jungle and play that, or drumming, and, you know, African drumming or something that would create mood that was extremely helpful in the, just the detailing. And it slowed me down too. If I was drawing a rainforest, I started putting monkeys in and butterflies and that just those details ended up being more, I wasn't rushing through the pages.
Yeah. What was the, I'd say, production process? We talked about your method last time we spoke, but did this go more quickly than other adaptations you've done? Or did you find this particularly challenging in terms of you know, not just the particular visuals, but, you know, doing it as a narrative, I guess?
Well, it was because it's a relatively long project. I mean, to sit down and I managed in a year to do, a little more than that, 150 page book. And that for, I'm not a superhero comic artist where I'm turning out a book a month or whatever, but,
that it was Howard Chaykin told me he had to do 25 pages a month. That was his,
that would not be my story. I suppose I could if I had to, but there's also just the marinating in it, in adapting the material and thinking about it and doing other things. Of course, sure. I also, while I was working, I was doing political cartoons and just the juggle of Spy versus Spy and other things that came into it. So it wasn't strictly that, but, I was able to get into it and having come off of all that adapting where I think I had a better sense of the attack by going from one book right into another. Mm-hmm. And even my six step process of thumbnailing and all that and finding what quotes I wanted and happily Heart of Darkness itself, the original book it's a novella and it's 75 pages.
Yeah.
And so I was doubling that length, which is close to what it should be in order to not cut out too much text, but then I'm not just simply going to have every word in there either. So but it's when it's a manageable size like that, it's better than say when I did The Jungle by Upton Sinclair, that was a 358 page book, which I had to reduce down to be for the format. I think it was 45 pages. So yeah. 48 pages. And that was very difficult.
I was going to say they didn't pitch Nostromo. They didn't go with Heart of Darkness as far as comic.
Exactly. Yeah. So good call on that. It's still as daunting, and some of it is my intention with almost any project is I'm trying to demonstrate what you can do with comics, and so for myself, just on a boredom level, I want to try and do interesting page designs and layouts, but I also want the story to direct me and inspire possibilities for doing unusual storytelling that could be take a reader somewhere that they weren't expecting, but not also be like, hey, look at me, look at what I've done with the page design, which is, the worst thing you can do, I think, is to have it be that the form is getting in the way of the story. And so I was really trying to do that juggle and still do sort of like some backflips of design and say like, I'm going to get your eye to go over here and do these things so that somebody who is not a comic reader necessarily will look at the form and maybe not even notice it. And then maybe on second viewing or whatever, or just, not notice it at all, but just have a good read, but that I know I've taken them on a journey with the form as well as with the story.
Do you feel you did anything, something unique to yourself, to your work? And were there moments you thought, I've never done this before, but let me try and see how this works.
There's a lot of, there's so many different characters in the story. There's so much costume. Drawing boats, I'm not a boat person. So getting nautical.
It was Jaime Hernandez's complaint that, I really wish I didn't set everything in Southern California because I hate drawing cars.
Oh, yeah.
So, well, similarly.
Heart of Darkness. These processes force you to do things. I mean, I have to draw buildings. I live in New York. I certainly initially was like, oh, God, every window. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do my version of it. But that looking at reference, there's a point where I'm resistant to it because I feel like I want to just be able to draw and have it in my head or bring it, from some imagination. And then there's the simple sitting down, the brass tacks of looking at the brass tacks, looking at rivets, looking at, the ropes on a boat and how that's strung together. And I did my shortcutting first stab and the editor looked at it and said, you're not going to be able to like fake nautical stuff. There's going to be nautical people that'll look at this and that probably might still be, but with a book, with a period piece like this, I had to look at, what's the flag that they actually used at that time? It's the British flag, but no, it's a special design from that era. And that all those details that come up all require taking a look. And I'm resistant on some level. I find it a little bit boring and the drudgery of just digging up all
the hyper accuracy.
I don't want, that's not really what I do. And I don't want to, get moved too far over into this realm of the super realistic, not like I'll ever be super realistic, but just too much so in that direction. But then when I do it and start there's a point where I switch gears and then I actually start really enjoying it. And then getting a reference is an exciting thing, because pretty much the reality of, you know, everything right down to, you know, pots and pans, they're just more interesting when you look at them. There's some added bonus in the design that makes it visually more interesting and is more interesting to draw.
And how much familiarity did you have with the Heart of Darkness before you started this?
Really limited, in fact. Yeah. You tell you the truth, more
high school?
More, no, not even high school. I actually no. It was Apocalypse Now was my familiarity, and all, you know, and all the key lines from the book. But I had not read it before I sat down with it here, which it just, you know, I don't know, no special reason it missed me, but it had missed me. And
that's okay. I bonded this weekend with a very accomplished professor of a guest who neither of us had read To Kill a Mockingbird.
There you go.
So yeah, there's always those holes. You're like, how the hell did that happen?
Yeah, no, well, actually, my daughter was had to read it for school, and so I read it. I might have read it earlier.
Yeah, everybody has.
But then
not me.
Yeah, no, well, there's things like that. And when you hit on them, you know, sometimes they're absolutely magical, and sometimes there is drudgery. I've taken a few stabs at Moby Dick, and it's just there's too much technical information there.
Yeah, I understand that, yeah.
But that said, I think there was some benefits to the fact that I came at it as a really fresh reader, because I didn't. Now, there's a certain degree to which I have to kind of like put on a shelf the notion that I am working on a classic, canonical classic, that, you know, how dare I, et cetera, et cetera. I have to like, okay, I'm doing this. I'm going to do this. And that I have to not be so daunted by the fact that this is something that scholars have argued over in both directions, and that, you know, people have been picking apart for years, and here I am coming to it. How dare I, let alone do I have the skills to do that? And that it was one of the things that's exciting about doing things like this. And one thing that I really enjoy about adaptation is it's like going back to school and being involved in a graduate class. And so I was, aside from rereading and rereading the book, I was listening to it read by several different actors. I looked up any references I could find to it, and then that deep dive that you get when you go on Google, and like, so I'm looking and I'm typing in Heart of Darkness, and then, or boats, or then period paintings, or what led to the
cat
the
videos.
Congo.
Just admit it was cat videos. That's where it all
it was. Cheeseburgers and cats. Yeah. You know, mostly that's what it ends up being. Yeah. And that all that ends up being this, which ended up, of course, being weeks and then, you know, months of just marinating in it. And especially, you know, again, with this flu, I couldn't get to the drawing part and a lot of consideration. And I also needed to have all that roll up, which I looked at, you know, the joy of YouTube. There was classes on it where, you know, big discussions on it, reading the critical edition that has all the different authors, Mark Twain talking about it, all the, you know, all the period pieces. Yeah. And then things like King Leopold's Ghost by Adam Hochschild and Maya Jasanoff's biography, and that you know, all those different things were getting into that history. And once I sort of dug in on that, then I find like, oh, this is what I want to be doing. Yeah. And then I held my breath, and I, you know, still am, to the extent that it's just getting out there in the world now, and we'll see how it is responded to. But that overall, my sense is, at least I brought a perspective to it based on what now is my little education on Conrad and the book.
You feel you're going to get called up as a Conrad scholar at some point to
not too much, but as a person of interest.
Yeah. Again, you've got the Harvard connection. They could bring you up there to lecture.
This is true. And actually one of the sort of surprising, wonderful things that happened was that Harvard acquired all the original artwork from that I did for Heart of Darkness. And in that process, I went up to Harvard to Houghton Library, and they let me take a look at Conrad's diary from his trip, from that particular upriver book.
Yeah.
And to hold that in my hands was like a transformative moment. I mean, it's another one of the things that comes through this is that the amount of time I spent with the material, therefore something like that, it's like a grail.
Yeah. It's the totem.
It's a totem. And having that feeling, that sort of like shaking excitement, which I have is, you know, I can pick up various comics and feel that, you know, look at original art that I'm, you know, going to a museum and see a painting, you know, Starry Night or Mona Lisa or something that, and you just feel like you're in the presence of something. And there, you know, there it was again, but I had this wholly new connection to the material.
The fact that it was English language versus the Kafka work where you had to work through translations into a visual translation, did that change the process for you at all?
I mean, absolutely.
You're losing that step.
Yeah, that's a huge thing.
But did that step that you went through with the Kafka stuff enhance the adaptation process? Did it make it any, you know, get you even more immersed or involved, I suppose?
I mean, I felt very immersed in the Kafka work, but there was a big question of capturing Kafka's voice that I, in reading different translations, I found that
there wasn't
the one that I always felt was Kafka's voice was a stilted translation that was coming from the 50s and it's the one I like. And I didn't mind. There was some other adaptations that were more updated that I liked aspects of, but a lot of it, if the language got too smooth, I felt like, oh, that's not Kafka's voice, right, which may not be true. I mean, he might have a more suave,
but it's your Kafka's voice.
But the one that I grew up on that I came to believe was the sound of Kafka. And I didn't have to go through that with Conrad, and it was more like just the careful reading to identify the details so that I didn't, you know, miss things. But I also made a really big point of showing this to as many people as I could, scholars. And I got, you know, a pretty hefty lineup of people, somebody from Princeton, Columbia University, Brown, Harvard. Yeah. And so that I made sure, like, you know, I know I'm going to get it when the book is out. Why wait? You know, I want to know right now when I can do something about it. Mm-hmm. And I also asked a really important voice was my sister-in-law, who works at the Whitney, which is the most politically correct environment you want to find. And so she was absolutely on me about, like, asking me about choices and very specific about, like, at one point I wanted to have an African woman's face on the cover of the book. And she was like, you can't do that. It will be, you know, it's an appropriation question. And I was like, but I'm my notion is that I'm flipping the perspective. And so I want to show that. And she's like, no,
you're well-intended.
Yeah. Well-intended.
This is what's going to happen.
This is, yeah. And it was, and I'm, you know, was so relieved. I needed that so much. And in fact, you know, it's a combination of things. Also, we're in a time period that it's ever escalating, being more conscious and how, and the ways that we sort of like what was okay that is shifting, but, you know, shifting for good reasons. And it's like that, unintentional racism that I know I harbor, that it's not, I wouldn't call it racism per se. It's just being uninformed about things, that it's ignorance.
The limits to our empathy, just in terms of we can't know what it's like.
Yeah. And you can, to the extent that, you know, again, the digging in and looking at it, but how I portrayed people, I wanted to do it with accuracy, and yet, you know, cartooning in and of itself is there's a caricature aspect, certainly the way I draw. And I could go much more wild on the white characters and, you know, the colonialists and perhaps I went overboard on occasion. That was where maybe I was getting my yayas out, but that
a number of them did have a sort of piggish appearance.
Well, you know, I looked at photos.
Yeah.
I can say a lot of piggish appearances in these colonialists. And you think about what they were doing. It's like, what kind of person was going down there and justifying the kind of actions they did? I mean, we're talking about half the population of the Congo was murdered, and that it was the numbers as high as 15 million people were killed. I mean, you know, speaking of Holocaust, it was insane. And the methodology that they used, the kind of horrific, various levels, and the characters that Conrad was basing, say, Kurtz on, who's a guy who's gone into the jungle, gone insane, and, you know, has done horrific things. There were the real people that did that.
Yeah.
You know, some of them, of course, were, you know, well-groomed, mustachioed fellows with, you know, a nice top hat on, but plenty of them looked piggish.
Mm-hmm. I was disappointed, by the way, in terms of what you kept and what you threw out in terms of the prose. The one description of Kurtz that's in the book, it's just his title, The Chief of the Inner Station. And that has stuck with me for decades in terms of, yeah, he's the chief of what's way up inside here, the inner station.
I should have showed the book to you.
Yeah, that's the thing. The one guy could have said, just find a way to get that one line in there. But
he's referenced that way many times.
But the chief of the inner station.
Yes.
But talk a little about that adaptation versus revision. Like in terms of, you mentioned, you know, extending things visually to get a greater clarity as to what was being alluded to in the prose. But how far does it go, I suppose, in that respect, adaptation and the act of revision?
Well, that's, you know, that's up to the adapter, of course.
And how far does it go for you,
I guess. Well, you know, and that's a line that I thought about quite a bit, and where, like, okay, am I stepping over here? There was a particularly important point in the book, and I will avoid any spoiler alert, but somebody dies, and that in Conrad's original text, it leaps Marlowe in telling the story, this important event happens, and then he goes off on a tangent talking about Kurtz, and it seems utterly inappropriate and emotionally vacuous. And I felt like that was one of, you know, certainly ambiguities of the book, but I felt like that is a more than unnecessary ambiguity, because what you've done is you've robbed the emotional intensity of the situation by doing that. And that I moved that particular scene, that shift to talking about Kurtz later in the book. And I'm like, okay, I'm doing something. I am going in with a hatchet here and saying, I'm going to actually rearrange some of the pieces of this puzzle. But I felt like what I was doing was organizing it in a way that you'd be able to see the puzzle, as opposed to a scattershot, which is how I felt as a reader.
Yeah.
And maybe that was, you know, again, a benefit of not having read the book. I came to it with this sort of fresh eyed thing. I'm like, what's going
on
here?
You
know, I didn't have a, you know, teacher explaining to him. No, it was brilliant what he did there. I just was like, I took it as a first time reader saying, like, I am very confused by that choice. And I found that other places where Marlowe's reaction, say, Marlowe is the protagonist who's telling the story, that his reaction to certain things that were horrific was fairly blank. And I just brought my own sensibility into that. And I said, you don't have a blank response to seeing something horrific.
Yeah.
That's, you know, so, but that doesn't change the text to have an expression on his face or a response. Let's just say that it's, you know, it's all in caps as opposed to his response, as opposed to lowercase.
Yeah.
And that is, it's, you know, it brings a slightly emotional rise to that scene, but that doesn't change what was being said in the story. So there was, I felt there were a lot of places, and again, that flipping of the perspective where I would say, why can't I show an African point of view here, a Congolese point of view in this scene, looking at the people talking in the distance rather than they're always in the distance.
Have it always about them in the fore.
That again didn't change anything about the text, but it switched the perception of who was front and center all the time. And so it wasn't just simply like, and it would be ridiculous, in fact, to have it like, it's the white point of view. I had read that Marco Polo, you know, and he's gone the Silk Road, clearly would have seen the Wall of China. It doesn't happen to mention it.
Yeah.
So there are things that were, you know, that these explorers saw, people would come across, that just somehow or another didn't make the foreground. And that as a reader and having traveled and gone to Rwanda and Kenya and Tanzania, and that having been in different parts of the world where I saw what was front and center in my own experience, and it wasn't just me. And, you know, we were definitely in the minority. And so that to bring that to the story seemed really natural. and that was part of my adapting, was again having my own perspective on it, and that what I felt like would make sense, made sense to me from the text, in places where I felt like Conrad didn't make sense. Mm-hmm. And the fact that this was a book that originally came out as part of a collection of three stories, and he considered it to be like
the throwaway,
no big thing.
Yeah.
And it certainly didn't see, as is tradition with so many works of art, is that you know, the artist doesn't know. And right. Even for that matter, you know, the critics didn't know. It wasn't given any like, wow, but wait, well, that one story was amazing. Yeah. And that's something that developed over time. So I recognize that he in writing, it was still a young writer also, and that this wasn't his, you know, polished gem per se.
Yeah. Did you see previous drafts or anything? Or did those exist?
I didn't.
I wonder if those would be an interesting.
If there was anything that I came across, like, no, you know what? I bet it was very limited, because he wrote this in something like 7 weeks. It was a super speedy.
Yeah.
You know, he wrote it in, and you know, there's still, I mean, I still have questions about like that process, which I'm sure I'll keep on you know, worrying out over the years as I talk to other people. But that he visited the Congo in 1890, and he didn't write this until 1899, and he wrote it in three parts for a magazine, Blackwoods magazine, and so yeah. It came out as, you know, separate. And I think I think in the footsteps of Robert Louis Stevenson, it was sort of like a Treasure Island-y.
Yeah.
Kind of approach.
An adventure story.
Yeah. Adventure story that, and he was a big fan of Robert Louis Stevenson. In fact, the listener in the story in Heart of Darkness, I used Robert Louis Stevenson's face as a reference.
Oh, for the,
I generally use like I look around for references, like who's going to play what character. And then sometimes I pick friends, and sometimes I find somebody that just like, oh, that lands, that feels like the right thing. And sometimes I just make it up.
Mm-hmm. Read other Conrad since?
Very little. I mean, yeah. Youth, I was digging into his background.
Yeah. I just wonder if since then it's been, you know, I should check out some of his other stuff, but
I've been reading, it's on my to-do list, but I've been reading so much about the Congo and, that time period and his life.
Yeah.
That in the roll up actually for the book coming out, I spent months just reading around that. Yeah. as you know, much more than his own writing. Mm-hmm. And so that's you know, so
you'd have some knowledge of what you were talking about.
There's more time.
Yes, so we think.
So we think. Yes, yeah. We like to think.
So adapting Things Fall Apart next, just to make it up to Achebe, is it?
that would be appropriate for sure. No, there's, you know, I mean, another way to go would be to flip the whole story and have it be told entirely from the
listen. My dream episode of Deadwood. Did you watch the?
I watched
the
some of it. Yeah.
Okay. There was the Chinese liaison guy, mm-hmm. the guy who represented the Chinese laborers there, and he had a smattering of English, and he and Al Swearengen would parlay, and then he'd go back and get the Chinese population on board in the town. My dream episode is one where it's a day in his life. And all the Chinese speak perfect English, and the round eyes are the ones who just sound like they're speaking gibberish.
Right, right,
and
right.
We get his perspective. And they never did
you
this.
You ought to write that one.
Oh, God. I am obsessed with, yeah. What's that guy's story? And what's his, you know, right. just let's take the world that none of us look at because we're in our privileged position.
Well, yeah. I mean, Orange is the New Black does that.
Yeah.
In a really wonderful way where they're constantly, you know, like pick up that thread and pick up this thread.
And they did a great job of the Trojan horse. We'll start with the pretty white girl, but really it's not about the pretty white girl. Yep. It's everybody else.
Not to mention the fact ways you watch her descend into being less and less of that, you know.
Well, prison will do that to you, supposedly. Not that I have any experience, but next adaptation, though? Are you thinking adaptation, or are you thinking
I'm thinking not adaptation, but that doesn't mean it won't happen for any number of different reasons. I think what I'm more likely to end up doing is sort of an amalgam of different works that I'm going to be reading, because I want to do something on climate crisis. That's just so like in our face.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm thinking about all the time. If I'm not thinking about Trump, which I tangentially am, I'm thinking about climate crisis as a result of everything that he's doing, or, you know, the minions that are out there. It's not Trump alone. Of course, it's teamwork here, but, So the book that should be showing up today is Silent Spring, Rachel Carson.
Yeah.
And that, and I was reading around like E.O. Wilson, and I'm also interested in insects. And so I've been cogitating on something that is about the insect world and how it's being affected, and how what that relationship is between the natural world and us, and that separation that we're having, that we've had for so long, that makes us blind to the fact, like, oh yeah, you can kill off a bunch of bees and, you know, no big deal. Oops, what about that pollination issue?
Went a little too far.
Yeah. So that and you know, then it's going to be a Black Mirror episode where there are, you know, electronic bees that will then fly in your ear and kill you. That area is of great interest to me, but I'll admit I'm at that, having done almost back-to-back three books, that Ruins really was a huge effort. It was years of working on that. And then I got into doing Kafkaesque pretty quickly thereafter. And Heart of Darkness was like back-to-back. And that was with this very specific time period that I said, yes, I think I can do it in that time period, which was definitely the
optimistic
race. Yeah. Well, I have the good fortune, in theory, for sure. The good fortune I think I have from just the joy of being in the field for a long time, you know, experience. Yes, that is, there's some really huge benefits to that. And one of them is that I can start looking at how much I can get done in a certain amount of time. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, that doesn't include when I, you know, getting sick or whatever.
Sure.
And the freelancer's deal is that you, if you get sick, you just keep on doing it. And you tend, I think you get sick fewer times because you can't afford to get sick. It's like you get sick at the end of the semester in college. You're like, boom, it's the last day, hand in the last test, and then you drop.
Collapse. Yeah.
And I did that like every semester, with something like this. So I'm feeling at once, of course, I'm also doing other work. I'm just finishing up a 15-page comic that's for a group called Safe Passage that is, they're going to give out free to immigrants, primarily from Central America and South America and Mexico, who are trying to get into the United States. And it helps them with the road to figure out like how to get a visa and what the process is. And it's done in comic book form with, butterflies as the monarch butterflies as the migrants, and cats as the lawyers, and dogs as ICE. Nothing against dogs, but it fell very neatly.
If you went with pigs, and, you know, I'm sure you would have gotten the door kicked in at some point.
So. Yeah. But also there's teachers there who are, you know, there's the dog character group, but, so I haven't been idle. Like that was an immediate follow-up to this. It was, and I just finished that up recently. And of course, Spy versus Spy is ongoing. Mad is not dead. Contrary.
Yeah, I was going to ask, what's the status of Mad?
The status of Mad is, it's a little bit Walking Dead now. I know that I have the virus in my system, and I may, you know, all I have to do is be cut and fall down, and then I too will be Walking Dead. But they will have a few aspects of the magazine that are new. I know they bought material, including from me, going back for a while, so they could have even probably a year of new material. I think the announcement of its death was premature, and you know, just kind of got out very quickly. And I'm doing a new Spy right like this week. I'm working on one, and I will be doing into the foreseeable future. They will keep Spy versus Spy as an original new edition. How many other parts of the magazine will be new, I will find out as they start reaching that point.
Yeah.
But it's not there yet. And you know, I feel bad for all the parts of the magazine that won't be new, say like the movie parodies and many aspects of it that are hugely important. I'm pretty certain that Sergio Argonis is going to continue with his,
Sergio
throughout the magazine and things like that. So that happily there's going to be some through lines, but, and you know, my good fortune that I'm one of those, but it ain't over yet. The fat Alfred hasn't sung yet.
So do you have the spies testifying in front of the House Intelligence Committee? Is that the, feel free
good
to use
call.
That.
Thank you. Thank you. Good. I covered. Okay. That covers this week's.
Yeah. I'm good at, you know, just throwing out little ideas, but not executing anything.
Yes. So that's good. No, ideas are, they're the easier part for sure. But a good seed planted.
Yeah, I figure.
I'm for that. So. Yeah.
When we last talked, you were talking about the struggle not to lose your mind with the day-to-day craziness we're living through. Gotten any easier? Gotten worse from your perspective? Are you getting numb?
No, I'm definitely not numb at all. Yeah. I get periodically horrified by one thing or another and anxious. I'm definitely super fortunate that drawing is a therapeutic action that I'm utilizing virtually daily. I mean, certainly 5 days a week. I get up in the morning and perhaps we talked about this last time. I can't remember, but my routine is like, I get up at about 7:30, 8:15. I get the New York Times delivered. So I'm looking at a real paper and go through it. I look at my news feed. If there's time, I also listen to Colbert, Seth Meyers, Samantha Bee, if she's up that week, and Daily Show, and a number of those other things. Jimmy Kimmel's also fantastic. And then by 9 o'clock, I have to have come up with an idea, sketched it up, taken a picture with my phone, and sent it to the New Yorker. And by 9:30, they say yes, or I hear nothing. And there's, and every day it's a little bit of failure for the most part. Yeah. And there's that feeling, that strange sense of like, okay, now I'm going to pick myself back up and do this again. And I'm a little disheartened because I really want to get the idea out and share it. You know, it's not the money, of course, it's nice to get paid for what you do. That's just psychologically good. But really a lot of it is like, I want a venue where that's going to get out there. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes I come to my studio and I draw the thing up fully anyway. And then that ends up being, a quarter of my day right there. And then maybe posting it or sending it to the Nation or some of the other places. I'm also working on a website that the Nation posts,
the op art.
With Steve Brodner and Andrea Arroyo, where we're posting 5 days a week, political commentary from a variety of artists. I'm also working on a new issue of World War III. And it's an unusual theme this time. It's the world we're fighting for is our theme. Yeah. So we're optimism, not our general area. It's going to be the world we're fighting against as well, thrown in there.
You define things in terms of their opposites.
Yes,
but yeah.
Yes. Actually, I'm very excited because I reached out to Jose Munoz, brilliant cartoonist.
I did the interview with him at
New School.
Yeah.
At Ben Ketcher's picture story event. I've been a super fan of his work since I saw it in Raw and the moment I saw it. And he's contributing to the issue, which is fantastic. And so having that, making those connections, talking about these things through the work, that is helping me a lot, but is definitely not numbing me to it because, I'm able to actually say work on a cartoon while I'm listening to the impeachment hearings or something. So I'm taking in that, and it's frustrating at a level that I'm just hanging on like everybody else for, at least the people that are interested in surviving in this world, and not as survivalists, hoping that, there's going to be some turning point that, the stars will, whatever Mars in retrograde or whatever the fuck has to happen to make it, turn this. So reality actually will come back a few steps and that, these scoundrels will, the evidence is all there. It's, I think Patton Oswalt said it's like watching a game of Wheel of Fortune where all the letters are up there and we're still trying to choose new letters. It's like it's there. Yeah. I've read
the entire thing has been answered.
It's been answered by them. Yeah. They keep repeating it, in fact, and yet we're standing here as though we're still trying to decide whether they said what they said. And that, again, like one of the things about art, I feel like a time like this, art can actually speak some kind of truth that even like photography is going to fail at because of the possibilities of doctoring it. That you're getting somebody's point of view in the drawing. It's not, it's not pretending to be, objective.
Yeah.
And it is a truth, and I really feel like we're struggling with, we're struggling with what is reality. And there's so many things that are real, breathable air, potable water, and people around the world are experiencing it direct, you know, firsthand. They're underwater. They're, yeah. you know, they're not, there's not like, gee, it would be terrible if the tide rises and, you know, we were submerged. And it's like, you know, check out Florida, New Orleans. You know, my contention is what we're going to see in the not so distant future is all this stuff about immigration. It's going to be people immigrating. A lot of people who actually maybe even voted for Trump who will be trying to immigrate north because they're going to be in an uninhabitable areas. And it's going to be the dries versus the wets.
Yeah.
You know, this is what we'll, you know, it's the new prohibition.
Until we get the day after tomorrow when the giant snowstorm comes in.
Oh, yes, well, there's that. So, well, you know, yeah. I mean, one thing I will say is that it is as exciting in this crazy way as a story, you know, a page turner where it's like, you just don't know what's going to happen next. You know, you have somebody steps forward and tells the truth. And that's like, whoa, that, you know, that just happened. You didn't see that coming. And then you have something where it goes the other way. And, but there's a lot of things that have been building up to this kind of crescendo. And I feel like this between now and the election is probably the most treacherous time, maybe in world history, but certainly in American history, because we're now coming up in a place where, you've got somebody who does not want to be unseated, who is tragically dangerous for the planet, and what stops will be pulled out.
Yeah.
And when it comes down to this actual point where, like, you leave office or you stay, it could be as simple as stealing the election. It could possibly be a win of some form. But I think no matter what, it's a steal, because when you consider gerrymandering and all the things that are have gone down, that there's a kind of monstrous cheat here, or just the sheer finances versus, you know, that it being financed at a level. But I think it's without a doubt, there's already cheating that has gone down, and it's right. going to, you know, not get better.
So my question, based on your response to the Bush administration, do you have escape plans in mind for a couple of years like you did in 2006?
You know, I don't have like Spaceship X to jump on. So yeah. I don't
Mexico's
see,
not
like,
as alluring as it was.
Well, oh no, Mexico is alluring as hell, but it's still like a round ball that we're living on.
Oh, yeah,
so
yeah.
There's that issue.
Well, I just mean escaping America. There's no escaping the climate change issue because we're all screwed. But
you know, I am such a fan of New York City.
Yeah.
And I do feel like the stand and fight, whatever that means. I'm a pacifist, but you know, I will shout loudly.
Resist.
You know. Resisting in all the many forms that we all are capable of doing. And I think that there's a lot of ways to resist. And I think, a big way to resist is simply to not become numb, to not say, ugh, you know, it doesn't matter if I recycle or not, or whatever the things that it's just sort of like, this is a lost cause.
Well, at this point it doesn't, because China's no longer taking our recyclables. So you know, everything we recycle just ends up getting dumped together. But
oh yeah, no, there, well, no, I mean, there's the pessimistic point of view is so large and real. I mean, Hasan Minhaj is another one of the shows that I watch religiously, and that, he just had a thing on fashion and I think it's called fast fashion.
Yeah. All the H&Ms and Zara's incredible environmental disaster.
Right. I mean, like stuff. One jacket, the quantity of water to do one of those. And also that the recycling is actually not recycling, is getting burned or wherever in Kenya. And so, it's a pretty pessimistic, the information that's coming in. If you were reading a ticker tape, you'd be going, uh-oh, there's a crash coming.
Yeah.
But even so, I mean, I have, you know, in my personal world, I have lots of reasons to be optimistic, and that, and for that matter, I mean, I have a near 23-year-old daughter, so I better goddamn well be optimistic about the, a future.
Yeah. What's her perspective?
She's,
on the future. I mean,
she's, concerned like many people her age, at the same time, fortunately, being 23 and the theater world and being interested in, you know, in being in school and having a lot of things that are distracting from just worrying, just joie de vivre, you know, being in love and again, running around and doing
you're immortal
things.
In your 20s, generally.
Yeah, know, there's a certain quality of that I definitely see written on her. But I also, you know, she's not walking around glum over that, but she's certainly conscious of it. She can't help but be, because I'm her parent, and so is my wife, and we're both certainly not unconscious.
Yeah. Although you get the rebellion side, the screw it, I'm going to be the opposite of my parents thing.
There is that. I don't, this isn't going to be one of those where she ends up on Wall Street from what I can tell, like all indications, unless there's, you know, a performance on Wall Street.
Nice. There's a weird one, because I don't think I asked in either of our past conversations. Where do your politics originate?
I would, you know, I think about that sometimes, like, because I know.
How did
like,
I end up like this?
You're not born, you know, you're not born being political. I would definitely, my parents were certainly very conscious liberal, and I was marching against the Vietnam War, I think in 1964 or five. Mm-hmm. In Cleveland. I was in downtown marching in a tiny little circle with my parents holding a sign, had no idea
what
it meant.
Doing,
but, yeah, what it meant. I like the sign was exciting and cool. And you know,
you rebel without a cause, yelling something about
LBJ and, you know, no way, I don't know. And a guy came up to me and grabbed me and called me a red. And I was like, I'm not even wearing a red shirt. I don't get it. What's red? What does that even mean? And those little tastes of it, you know, like going out for a Halloween trick-or-treating where go to somebody's door and they say, who are you voting for? I'm like, I'm six. And we went LBJ. And he said, Goldwater, and slammed the door. These little memories, you know, these little things that trickle down. But my father was a professor. My mother was very active. She was in PAND, which was like Musicians Against Nuclear. I can't remember what the acronym stands for, but it was a, they were both very proactive that way. My father was involved in the Sierra Club and zero population growth and all these fairly early on. Mm-hmm. And Mad Magazine was hugely important because I saw in Mad them making fun of Nixon and you know, there was the certainly Watergate and all that that was passing through the pages. And I was like, that, you can be funny and do that. Gayn Wilson, who just passed recently, and I'm, you know, it's a super loss to this community. I saw his work. Playboy published this book called I Think I Won that has a guy on a battlefield, post-apocalyptic battlefield. And then the images in the book are all these, you know, there are things about guns, and there's a lot of environmental things. Mm-hmm. A big moment for me was also I saw the film Failsafe when I was eight. And in a quick recap, accidentally the United States bombs Russia. There's a point where they can't call the airplane back and it gets scrambled and it bombs Moscow. And that in order to stave off Third World War, the president of the United States has to allow Russia to bomb one city, and they bomb New York City. And I was like, what? And then, you know, the bomb drops and everything goes white and everybody disappears. And that just never left me. I mean, I went to bed that night in a cold sweat, and I've thought about the bomb in one way or another ever since. And that's just been hovering there, and it still is, but it functions as a motivator for me for the most part. Cause I'm like, got to get the book published before the bomb drops.
Right. I might get
So those are little like pieces of like information that suggested like, oh, we can do these things and this is what war can mean. And there was, you know, Hiroshima and Nagasaki after all, there were examples of, this actually has taken place. World War II, you see the Holocaust, you see, you know, I lived in Israel for a year, went to the Holocaust Museum when I was a kid, and, you know, seeing people in concentration camps and seeing these images of children, the Anne Frank house, you know, I read Diary of Anne Frank when I was her age or younger. Actually, I was probably 11 and went to the Anne Frank house, and I was, you know, it was stunning. So all those things end up being, you know, part of it. And Kurt Vonnegut's writing, you know, people who were writing anti-war books, Joseph Heller's Catch 22, the bits and pieces of that, that were all informing. I never was like a big news junkie in, say, you know, junior high school, even high school. I was aware of it, and I was still trying to keep straight whether it was South Vietnam or North Vietnam that we were where I was like, I can't remember. I know. Isn't North supposed to be good? We're from the North, right? You know, isn't it the Southerners? I don't know. So
let's see. The war of Vietnamese aggression, but go on.
Yes. Right. So, you know, there was the bits and pieces of those, that kind of stuff flowing in. And then actually underground comics were really important to me. Comics like Slow Death that were environmental, like right when Earth Day happened in 1970, I was reading those comics, and they were about talked about the Vietnam War, and they talked about, you know, aside from sex and drugs, yeah, there was all this other social context in there that was really meaningful. And, you know, and absolutely the lid ripped off, yeah, of, wasn't going to pussyfoot around.
Yeah, the FBI was right. This stuff was subversive in a good way.
Yeah, yeah. In a fantastic, you know, Mad, you know, the irony that Mad was the only thing standing from EC Comics at the, you know, end of the story, yeah, is one of the great ironies of what censorship can lead to.
Yeah.
You know, I'm hoping that that kind of thing happens again, that the, that this kind of environment that we're in that is so horrific, where every, you know, rule of law and everything is being thrown under the bus, that it will in fact propagate a new movement in the opposite direction, because it'll be like, oh, right, like McCarthyism, what McCarthyism did. I always wondered how the hell that, you know, people, like, everything turned like that. And when Trump came in, and you know, and not like there weren't examples of it in,
yeah,
other presidencies, but when Trump came in, it was like, oh, I see how this happens now. You know, they're putting down these off the hook, you know, Stephen Miller, anti-immigrant laws that are, no one ever thought could possibly be implemented. And here they are, you know, kids in cages and, you know, just people being killed at the border. Essentially, it's jaw dropping.
It is one of the, when I recorded with Harold Bloom at the beginning of 2016, he told me, I asked him what he was reading, and he said, Sinclair Lewis, It Can't Happen Here. And I was perfect. Like, oh, for God's sake, you're exaggerating. He's like, no, I'm not, son. And, yeah, and as,
well, he's of age, though, to
have,
you know, seen it actually come through, yeah, where, you know, I mean, if you were around, you know, I mean, you know, the blacklist lasted into the 70s.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
so there, I mean, and probably, and you'd say it destroyed enough lives in between there that it lasted, period. It's still going,
right,
on.
But yeah, it's one of those we just thought we were,
but this is where, you know, this is where art comes in, where, yeah, we're literally, you know, it's instructive, and you can read about things people have been writing about this, and there's enough, and science fiction too, you know, I mean, environmental movement and all that, there, the sci-fi writers were doing so much and basically saying, hey, you know, it's, there's going to be all this facial recognition and you know, eye scans and all the things, you know, you read there, and here we are now. I mean, I was just reading the paper this morning, yeah, about the concern that for trying to figure out when a video has been tampered with, where you say, like,
oh, the deep fake stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Deep fake is like, that's a really, yeah, you know, I mean,
how do we know this is a doctored video versus,
exactly, yeah, you know, and that all you need is like it to happen, you know, to drop at the right moment before, you know, you find out later, oh, no, that wasn't, you know,
yeah, that, because it's a combination, you know, of technology doing that sort of thing and human nature, which is willing to believe the shittiest thing possible and not bother listening to the reality.
And also, we haven't caught up with the idea that images like that are utterly up for grabs and could easily, yeah, be faked.
Yeah. But also that people want to believe shitty, horrible thing. People want to, absolutely, think that Nancy Pelosi was drunk.
Right.
Not that a video was doctored to, right, speed up and slow
down. And I know,
down.
I mean, I watch Jimmy Kimmel, so I know what drunk Trump looks like. So,
yeah. So. Again, because late night TV is salvation for you. So,
oh, it is.
They just watch it the next day.
Oh, it is. Absolutely. Yeah. It's, I just catch everyone. I do the YouTube, yeah, you know, best of monologue, and that's, oh, it's life saving.
Yeah. How's the reception been? I know it's only been a few weeks so far, but Heart of Darkness, how is it being?
It is just been a few weeks, but
have you received an angry cancel culture diatribe yet? Is what I'm wondering.
I have not.
Oh, good.
In fact, actually,
congratulations.
Well, I got probably the best review that I have ever gotten for any book. NPR reviewed it, and,
oh, yeah,
and they were,
yeah,
saying, you know, basically that I'd like to quote it directly, and I can't remember off the top of my head, but it was basically that I've taken the subject matter and shaken it up enough that people will reconsider what the book. Mm-hmm. And that is my dream to have come out of this, is that I was able to do that. That it is in fact in some way making the book even more relevant. That, you know, there's aspects of the book that are incredibly relevant. I mean, ironically, Joseph Conrad was born in the Ukraine. So it's like, here we are right up. It's like, wow, this, you know, you could draw some lines here and, you know, that, he was one of the few people that I wasn't actually in on trying to, you know,
of all things. It didn't work for the energy company. Yeah. Though. That was, I'm just kidding.
Yeah. He's the only person who's not involved in this, in the Trump scandal. Yeah. That, you know, the subject matter, the circumstances, what it's talking about, and the reason why I think it deserves to be canonical is because it is talking about this notion of being civilized and being, you know, what is civilized and what is savage, and that it touches on things that are going on right now in our very real world, and the madness of power and that circumstance that we're seeing in our own president that is like a character from a novel. In fact, I mean, it really is. I really feel like we're getting a Shakespeare version of almost it's too much of a caricature.
Yeah. I was going to say it's shitty Shakespeare
Shakespeare. That would pretty much,
I still think it's a lot like a Norman Spinrad novel from the '70s, but it turned out to be real.
This is again where, you know, you read science fiction. It's like, you might as well be reading the newspaper.
Yeah,
today.
We saw all this stuff for the last couple of decades.
Yeah, but this has been around, and environmentalism in a really big way. They've been talking about in science fiction books for, you know, Bradbury was, you know, one of these guys where you were reading about these very things, you know?
Yeah. Last question, only because you're a pacifist and I asked Stephen Heller the same question. Okay to punch a Nazi?
Wow. Well, it certainly is satisfying to watch with music in the background, but I'm enough of a pacifist to say that I'm not for that because I think that it's
violence begets violence.
Yeah. It's the road to ruin. When you get down that, then it's like, what's okay. You know, then there's mob mentality and that happens. It doesn't matter which side it's on. Then you start ripping somebody apart and you go, whoops, wrong guy. Yeah. You know, it's the same, you know, I'm not going to get a gun. I'm sure if I got one, I'd aim at the very, very dangerous attacker and I'd shoot the little girl standing behind him. So these things, I think they're best avoided, but then again, there is also, surviving, you know, if it comes down to having your personal life threatened, punching a Nazi, A-okay.
Peter, I'll let you go. And good luck with Heart of Darkness.
Thank you.
And that was Peter Kuper. His new book is Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness from W.W. Norton. To learn all about Peter's work, the books, the editorial cartooning, the gag comics, the art direction, World War III Illustrated, and all the other stuff that he's done over the decades, visit his site, petercooper.com. And that's PETERKUPER.com. He's on Instagram as Kuper Art, all one word, Twitter as P. Kuper Art, all one word, and Facebook as peter.cooper.75. And always, Kuper is K-U-P-E-R. Now, after we wrapped, I asked Peter, so, who you been reading? If you want to hear his answer to that and get some extra conversation, you'll need to become a supporter of the Virtual Memories Show so you can get access to our quarterly bonus podcast, Fear of a Square Planet. The third quarter 2019 episode is up now, and it features an hour of book recommendations and fun conversation with Carl Stevens, Emily Nussbaum, Kate Maruyama, Lanier's, Christopher Brown, Caleb Crane, David Shields, Dawn Raffle, Amor Tolles, Simon Doonan, Simon Critchley, and Sylvia Nickerson. You can support the Virtual Memory Show via patreon.com/VMSpod or paypal.me/VMSpod. I've got all sorts of goals and goodies in place for patrons, including that podcast, a patron-only blog, handwritten show notes for every episode, my secret project, and more. So go to patreon.com/VMSpod and support the art of fine conversation. Now, I recorded this episode at Peter's studio in New York City. That means $12 at the GW, another $30 for parking, but it's all in walking distance of the garage, so no subway fare this time. Oh, I also got a coffee. Oh, now that I think about it, I didn't even pay for the bridge or parking because this was wedged in between two meetings with a Japanese client of mine and the Economic Development Center for the city of Yokohama. So they covered, my business covered the bridge and all that. So yeah, I got off free on this one. Still, if you want to help defray some of the costs of the virtual memory show, like web hosting, travel, equipment, and coffee, or just toss me some money because you think the show is worth it, then visit patreon.com/VMSpod or paypal.me/VMSpod and make a one-time or recurring donation. Special thanks go out to Nick Bartosik, Buzz Carter, Michael Hacker, Michael Janizek, Fred Kish, Annie Koyama, Jonathan Kranz, Kevin Katila, Jack Lescamella, Stephen Nadler, Barbara Nessim, Jim Ottaviani, George Pfau, Payne Prophet, Dmitry Samarov, David Small, Stephen Solomon, Greg Tanner, Ford Thomas, Armando Veve, and Garrett Zecker for going over and above in their support of the Virtual Memories show. We have the full list of show supporters at chimeraobscura.com/VM. Our music for this episode is Fella by Hal Mayforth, used with permission from the artist. You should visit my archives to check out my episode with Hal from the summer of 2018 and learn more about his art and painting. And you can listen to his music at soundcloud.com/Mayforth. And that's M-A-Y, the number 4, T-H. And that's it for this week's episode of the Virtual Memories Show. Thanks so much for listening. We'll be back next week with another great conversation. You can subscribe to the Virtual Memories Show and download past episodes at the iTunes Store. You can also find all our episodes and get on our email list at either of our websites, vmspod.com or chimeraobscura.com/VM. You can also follow the Virtual Memories Show on Twitter and Instagram at vmspod, at virtualmemoriespodcast.tumblr.com, and on YouTube, Spotify, and TuneIn.com by searching for Virtual Memories Show. And if you like this podcast, please tell your pals, talk it up on social media, and go to iTunes, look up the Virtual Memories Show, and leave a rating and maybe a review for us. It all goes to helping us build a bigger audience. You've been listening to the Virtual Memories Show. I'm your host, Gil Roth. Keep reading, keep making art, and keep the conversation going.